I know that Megan had kind of introduced me already, so I wanted to give you guys a little bit of my background. A lot of people end up looking at me and they automatically are trying to guess what my ethnicity is, and 90% of the time they can't figure it out. So, who am I? My name is Anna Yang. I was born Anna Her. I am actually of Hmong ethnicity. Raise your hand if you've heard of the Hmong. Woohoo! Go you guys. So my parents actually were born in Laos, in this particular region of Laos, up here in the mountains. And they were, my grandfather fought in the Vietnam War, because apparently what had happened was communism had come into Laos, and the Americans got into Laos to try to stop the Ho Chi Minh Trail that basically supplied all of the supplies into Laos from Vietnam, from the North Vietnamese. So basically, the Hmong people decided, we don't want to fight in this war, we'll join with Americans and fight them. And in the end, the Americans pulled out of the Vietnam War, and so the Hmong were left as essentially enemies of the state and were hunted down by the communist army, and all of them fled. So they left, and most of them basically crossed the Mekong River into Thailand, into refugee camps, which is where my parents were born. Not born. They met each other in the refugee camps, and then left in 1982, and ended up in Kansas City, which is where I was born and raised. So lucky me, my mom was 7 months pregnant when we got to the United States, and I was born in April of that year. So born and raised, did all of my primary and middle and secondary schooling in Kansas City, decided that Kansas City was not cool enough for a person like me, and headed down to Georgia. So I came down to Georgia for school. Anyone know what this is? It's Toccoa Falls. Yes, Toccoa Falls. So I ended up going to school, Toccoa Falls College, decided that maybe I was going to teach overseas. So came down here, and ended up getting engaged to my husband, who was like, no, you're not going out of the country. So we ended up staying here in Georgia, and I finished my degree in secondary education history with a minor in TESOL, and got a job right after I finished student teaching at Norcross High School in Gwinnett County. So I started teaching there in 2005, and I was hired to teach sheltered world history. Anyone know what sheltered is? Good. Sheltered is basically a self-contained class of English language learners. But what we do as certified content area teachers is we deliver the content using strategies that will help our English learners to be able to understand the content. Because here's the thing, your secondary learners who are English language learners, they come to the United States at 13, 14, 15, 16 year olds, they are still held to the same exact accountability measures as all of your grade level peers. So they still have to pass high school exams. They still have to pass all of their content classes in order to graduate from our American schools. So that's what I did. I taught sheltered. And then a lot of legislation started kind of being placed in the state of Georgia, and that diminished our ESOL population. So I slowly got switched into gifted and honors world history, and then decided that I wanted to get my master's degree. So where did I come? To UGA. So I worked up here in the language and literacy education department on my master's, finished that up in 2011. And then I got pregnant, had my baby. And so I am the wife of Abraham and Waverly's mommy. So that's a little bit of my background. So here is just kind of like a written summary of everything I just shared with you. Okay, so what I've been asked to do with you guys today is to take a look at what it's like to teach English language learners in just a regular mainstream classroom. This is becoming more of the norm than it is the exception nowadays. A lot of the times because of budget cuts. I think one of you guys had asked that in one of your questions. So budget cuts have really hampered personnel and staffing, and that's the reason why a lot of teachers are starting to see English language learners in their classrooms. Still, we are obligated to serve them in other areas for English services purposes, but you are still gonna see those English learners in your classroom, and you are gonna see where they're struggling. And hopefully what I'll be able to give you guys today are some nuggets to take back to work with your English learners. So I've got two kinds of objectives that I want to work into what we're doing today. First is a language objective. This is going to be something that I'm hoping you guys will start to think about adding into your lesson plans, language objectives. Now, I know you guys are language arts teachers, right? So it's easy for you to think about what the language objective might be. But as you guys get into the schools, you'll find that a school is not a place for us to be islands. We have to work with people in our schools. And so hopefully you'll extend your reach beyond just your language arts teachers to other teachers in other disciplines as well. And as you do that, encourage them to also think about the language of their content areas. What language is needed for science? What language is needed for math? What language is needed for social studies? And so on and so forth. So language objectives are really important when we're thinking about our language learners. And essentially, we're all language teachers because all of our kids, regardless of where they come from, whether they were born here in the United States or whether they were born outside of the United States, they all still need to master language of some sort to become proficient and academically successful. So what we want to do with language is listen to information presented on English learners and ways to make instruction more accessible to them. And then we'll also be discussing instructional strategies to make this instruction more accessible to them. Our content objective, obviously, the content is what we're going to be getting at today. Understand who these learners are, understand what their learning needs are, and then identify ways to make our instruction accessible to them, okay? Now, the first thing I want you guys to do is what I call an activating strategy. You guys might have heard of this already. It's kind of like that warm-up at the beginning of class that you use to start trying to figure out what your kids know. So you guys have in front of you a chart. It's called what we call a vocabulary quilt. I asked for each of you to take a different colored marker because each of you are going to take a couple of minutes on this chart and just jot down anything you know about those eight concepts, okay? So I'm gonna give you guys 3 minutes, I'm gonna time you, and just take your markers and just write whatever you know about those eight concepts. And if you want to use your native language, you are more than welcome to. If you want to draw pictures, you're more than welcome to. You are not limited to having to just write in English or just words. And feel free to talk it out with each other. Use each other's resources.
All right. I know, me too. No, I got up. I caused mass chaos. Yeah.
Megan, do me a favor. Help me get these students. Oh, I just disconnected someone.
I think we're supposed to write up. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't even do that.
Word clouds.
They got four, so they need one more. And the last one is yours.
Do you mind if I?
Yeah, it's yours. I have one. Do you need an extra one? Okay, you guys got about 45 seconds left. All right, go ahead and wrap it up and head back to your seats. Continue through the presentation with my explanation of what these eight different concepts are. feel free to add to it. And if there are things that you realize, oops, this was not what she was talking about, feel free to cross it out. At the end of the entire session, we'll do a summary activity using this particular chart, okay? Any questions so far before we move on? Good? All right. I have a tendency to talk a little fast. So if you notice that my rate of speech is starting to go a mile a minute, let me know. Just kind of like, Megan, tell me to calm down. Okay, let's start out by reading this letter here. Dear Mother, although I enjoy teaching, my teaching very much, it is very hectic. There are 28 students in my third grade class. Six speak English. The rest speak a bewildering variety of eight other languages, of which I know a few words of only three. With the others, we use sign language and get along as best as we can. I'm working to get parents to translate, but most of them know no English. I hope next year to get a better start with language. Sound familiar? Have you guys seen or experienced any of this? No, not yet? This is not something current. This is actually written in 1908 by a teacher in Brooklyn. This was from a letter that was found in the University of Pennsylvania Library and published in Teaching Tolerance in the spring of 1999. Makes sense though, right? With the influx of immigration from the early 20th century, definitely, this is not a recurring kind of experience. Immigration was something we experienced a long time ago, and it's something that we're experiencing even now. All right, so who are these English learners that you guys are experiencing in your classroom? Well, I had to put this in. I know it's kind of silly, but you would be surprised to hear that people associate English learners with Hispanics. Yes, they are a large majority of the EL population, but they are not the only people who are in the ESOL program. In fact, one of the most frequent questions I get when I tell people that I teach ESOL students is, do you speak Spanish? And the answer is no, I don't speak Spanish, but I also don't speak Romanian, nor do I speak Vietnamese or Chinese or Kanabal. I don't speak any of those languages, but what I have been trained to do is to deliver instruction in a way that is comprehensible to my students, regardless of what language they speak. So they are not just Hispanic students. We have a lot of different acronyms that we use to basically describe our English learners. The state of Georgia has reduced it to just EL for English learners, but they are also called ELLs, which are English language learners. They are also often referred to as ESOL students. ESOL stands for English to Speaker of Other Languages. Earlier you saw the TESOL acronym, that's Teaching English to Speakers of Other Languages, or sometimes Teachers of English. Now, why did we change it to Speakers of Other Languages instead of as a second language? How many of you guys have heard it before as English as a second language? Yeah, why did we change it? Anyone have any ideas? Yes.
Not always second language, third or fourth.
Absolutely. A lot of the times these kids come into our classrooms and English is not the second language they're learning. If you get a kid who's coming here from China, they've probably already learned some other language. Maybe they've already been learning Korean or Japanese in their schools, or maybe they've already been learning English, who knows. If you get a kid from Europe, they've probably learned French as a second language and they're learning English as a third language. So we had to change it just to make it more politically correct to represent the vast array of students who come into our classrooms. We've also heard them called LEPs, which are limited English proficient students, but this one is starting to kind of phase out because it takes on more of a deficit perception of our ESOL students. So we're seeing them as limited versus actually coming into the classroom with a wealth of other resources. So in the state of Georgia, we look at these students based on their float. If we send home basically parents, I know, sounds funny, we send home surveys to parents who are basically bringing their kids to the schools, and the surveys will ask the parents if their students speak another language at home that's different than English. If they check yes, then that automatically flags the school system and tells them that they have to make sure that they check to see if these students need language services. So if they have a float, a primary home language other than English, then we flag them. The second thing we do is we go ahead and we test them. So we have to have a language proficiency assessment of some sort. The state of Georgia uses the ACCESS test and the WIDA, which is basically a consortium out of Wisconsin, University of Wisconsin-Madison. And that's what we use to assess our students. So if they do have a float and they qualify based on the test, then they are served in ESOL. Okay, demographics-wise, we are the 12th largest in ESOL population in ELL enrollment, the 12th largest. And we have had a 246.7% increase in 10 years. Our state really does represent one of the states that's burgeoning in ESOL students and really needs for more teachers to be trained. So Today, I'm also going to pitch one more thing to you besides just giving you information. Consider the ESOL endorsement and what that might do for you if you're looking for a job as soon as you guys get out of this program, okay? The ESOL endorsement is really going to show that you are a highly qualified teacher because you've added all this extra wealth of instructional resources to your belt, okay? So, lots of English language learners in the state of Georgia. These are the top five languages spoken by ELLs: Spanish, Vietnamese, Korean, French, and Chinese, respectively, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I forgot to let you guys know, I put a handout on your desks that basically goes through the presentation as well and gives you all this information. Now, every so often I'm gonna stop, which is what I'm gonna do right now, and I'm gonna do what's called a 3-minute pause. This is usually a good time if you're having to give a lecture like what I'm doing, to just give time for your students to let the information sink in. Also, when you start seeing yawns, that's usually an indication, okay, stop, let's do something else. Okay, so here's what I want you guys to do. At your tables, you have this handout, it's on your table, on your handout as well. I want you to take 3 minutes and I want you to discuss any experiences you have right now with English learners at any of the schools that you're currently assigned, okay? I want you to think about these things. How large is the population? How aware of you is the population, is the size of the population? What ethnicities and languages are represented in your schools? And how are these cultures represented in the school? So take 3 minutes, just kind of discuss with a partner at your table, and you can just kind of jot down your responses on a piece of paper, and then we'll see what you guys come up with in 3 minutes. Go. Wow. Where are you at? So, yes, sir.
So anything when it comes to school?
California. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's typically California, Arizona, Florida, New York are like top. Yes.
Oh, no. Mine's similar. None of them have. He's only in there because he's absent for a lot of school. He has to go work with his family. There's a kid who's doing like a, I'm sure it's called a study abroad program or something. Fourth period class, I know he's from Europe, but he speaks fluent Russian.
And even besides
her, there's
just a majority of the
Okay, as you wrap up your conversations, I want you guys to start thinking about one person to represent your group to kind of just report out anything interesting that you guys learned about each other's schools. All right, are you ready? Okay.
Sure.
Let's just take volunteers for now before I volunteer people to share what you guys might have heard from your experiences with EL students in your classes.
Place my school on that. My teacher is one of two ESOL teachers. He teaches a sheltered English class. And I'm not sure about the whole school's population of ESOL students. I know there's 17 in my class, and that's for all the grade levels of English. The ethnicity is Burmese, which is very popular because Madison County is a place where the Burmese are actually
Oh, yeah,
to.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of Burmese, some from Thailand, some from Vietnam, and then Hispanic would make up the rest of the population.
Incredible.
I think there's a few Korean too, but it's mostly Burmese that children come.
Wonderful. Anyone else? Yes.
I'm out much farther east, and it's not as diverse. I'm in middle school, so in the entire middle school there are 3 Hispanic kids and 1 Asian girl, and that's it. Everyone else is everyone else has lived there for a very long time. The only English language learner. There's 2 Hispanic boys that are in middle school. That's it.
Fascinating. Sounds very, very similar to North Hab Middle School, which is where I work with some teachers up there right now with what I'm doing at the University of Georgia. I think they have 8 students in the whole middle school who are ESOL students. Yes?
We all have ELLs in our schools. I think mine was probably most diverse, though. My husband's school is very diverse. I think in every class that my mentor teaches, there's at least 5 different languages.
Huh.
But the thing that I kind of struggle with is that I've started kind of working on my ESL endorsement.
Great.
I want to finish it in grad school. I can't finish it before I graduate. And so I always want to try to come up with differentiation for things that we can do to reach those students. Mm-hmm. But because they're all pre-AP classes, my mentor teacher says they don't need it. So,
ouch.
Yeah.
Oh, that hurts a little. Yes.
Our group universally said that the biggest population was Hispanic, definitely. And we were talking about how it kind of depends on the grade level too. Callie teaches, her MT is honors, so there's not a lot of ESO. There's not kids that struggle with English in her class, whereas one of my classes CP, and there's a couple kids at least that should be in shelter class and aren't. So the budget cut that you were talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right.
We had a similar experience. Most of the students that we have are also Hispanic, but there are only slight numbers in each of our schools who seem to have difficulty with the language at times. The rest of them are pretty fluent. So it's just having deliberate instruction with them and understanding that a whole lot of our students are code switching the moment they walk out the door.
Mm-hmm.
They speak with their friends primarily in Spanish.
Definitely. I love that you mentioned this whole idea of some teachers, I guess, not perceiving ESOL students as AP material. And I love that you mentioned the variation between honors level courses and CP courses. If you are teaching in a high school where there is that differentiation, or even in middle schools where there's what advanced and then regular, you will see this a lot. Those ESOL students have a tendency to be placed in the lowest tier. And it's really heartbreaking. I actually had an experience with one of my students who came from Mexico. She was just stellar in my shelter course her freshman year. So we moved her into an honors course by the spring semester. So she was a freshman, and so she did sheltered the first semester, moved her into honors second semester, and then by 11th grade, she was ready for AP. So pre-AP, for teachers to just kind of make a blanket statement that all ESOL students are not really AP material, it does kind of hurt, because you have to really be deliberate in your instruction. You have to get to know your students. You have to find out where they are, because some of your students are going to come with a lot of schooling and are going to be ready and prepared to jump into AP once they've mastered the language, and others are going to be schooled longer in the United States. They're going to struggle a little bit more, and you're going to see that pattern a lot. So if you have a kid, which is going to really be great for our next segue, if you have a kid who you see speaks so well in English, but on paper they struggle, there's always a reason for that. So look into their background, dig a little bit deeper, talk to the ESOL teacher who has records of all of this information, and find out why the student is where he or she is, okay? So wonderful, wonderful insights. Okay, so today what I want to do with you guys is give you guys a crash course on six different things to consider. Now, I know that you're looking for instructional strategies. This is what teachers are typically hungry for. They want me to give them a piece of paper and say, use this, it's going to be great. But what I want you guys to understand, too, is that there are a lot of other things to consider when you're teaching your ELLs that go beyond just a piece of paper. And so that's really what I want to do today as well, is not just give you strategies on paper that you can take back to work with your kids, but also to give you things that you need to consider internally as a teacher in preparing your lessons to teach your students who may or may not include ELLs, okay? But here's the key to remember. Here's the key point to remember, though. Good teaching is just good teaching, right? And a lot of what we do as ESOL teachers is good teaching because we are looking at the child where they are, trying to figure out what they know, bring that into our instruction, figure out ways to get them where they are to where we need them to be, and then assess them to see if we did a good job with that. That's just good teaching. And that's really what you guys want to think about as you're writing your lesson plans and planning your instruction for your students, which may or may not include ELLs, okay? So six things. Number one, conversational versus academic language. We'll talk about that. Number two, comprehensible input, social interaction, native language influence on the target language, the affective filter, and linguistic form and function. So these are six things that we're going to be looking at. These are part of the concepts that are on your guys' vocabulary quilt, okay? Okay, so let's get started. I need four volunteers. Jump, jump, jump. Four volunteers. Come on up. Come on up, come on up, come on up. Sorry, I ended up picking all girls. Not intentional. Okay, so these four volunteers are going to be our language experts, okay? So you guys are my audience. It's okay, you're fine for now, okay? As we start adding more stuff, you might want to move off to the side. Okay, so here's what I want you guys to do. I would like for you guys to tell me a story about what you guys did this past weekend. Now, it's a chain story, so we'll start with you. What's your name?
Victoria.
Victoria, and then we'll go to?
Lauren,
and then?
Callie,
and then?
Heather.
Okay. Victoria, Lauren, Callie, Heather? Okay. All right, so we'll start with Victoria. When I buzz you, you're going to stop, and then you're going to pick up. And when I buzz you, you'll pick up, and then so on and so forth, okay? So just kind of be creative. Just, you know, if you want to be silly, be clean. But be silly if you want to, okay? All right, you ready? Go.
This weekend, I watched about 8 episodes of How I Met Your Mother on Netflix. Mm-hmm. It was really great, and then I slept.
Buzz.
And then I woke up, and then I did some homework, and then I slept some more. And I also went home to see my parents.
Buzz.
And my little brother was there, home from college as well. And so we all had a great family dinner together and kind of talked about our classes.
Buzz.
And then I had to go to work, and I spent 12 hours straight there, and it was not fun. And then I watched the TV.
Okay, great. Now, weren't they great? Did they do such a great job? Yeah. It was a very cohesive story. It flowed so well. It was beautiful, wasn't it? Okay, all right, we're going to change things up a little bit, and I'm going to need your guys' help, okay? Now, what I want you to do is I want you to talk to me about photosynthesis, okay? Not only that, I want you to talk to me about photosynthesis without using any words that begin with the letters L, P, S, and T. If you guys hear them using any words using the letters L, P, S, and T, we'll buzz them, give them a second chance, and then we'll move on. You guys got it? You know what you need to do? Do you guys know what you need to do? Okay, are you ready? So, Victoria, right? Go for it.
Okay, that right thing.
Buzz! Oh!
Okay, I'll start over.
Yeah, start over.
Right.
Oh, no, no, it's okay. Just start with the
T. Sorry.
Right,
yellow. Green. out of the ground.
Oh, okay. Moving on.
It's about bright yellow coming down. Focusing on vegetation.
Oh, she's doing good, huh? Okay, well, all right, moving on. Nutrients is good, yes.
Makes other things.
All right, let's move on.
Green organisms get nutrients from big yellow circle in. And converts energy into food for itself.
Woo! Wow. Give Victoria, Lauren, Callie, and Heather a hand. Great job. Okay. All right. So, ladies, how did you feel about this activity? First and then second. The first one and then the second one.
I felt fine with the first one, and then I felt incompetent the second one.
Why did you feel incompetent?
Because I knew what I wanted to say, but I couldn't. I felt the same way.
Yeah.
Especially because I still don't know if I'm like, we're being very honest. So having to like describe this really difficult process without using like plants or sun, it's really hard.
Yeah. Yeah. Heather?
My sister's a biomedical engineer, so I don't know what kind of synthesis is. But it was definitely easier for me because three people went before me, so I had more time to think about it.
Very good.
And the only thing that was really difficult is I had to like think. I caught myself, and y'all caught me before I said it as well. When I wanted to say sky.
Oh, we thought you were gonna say a word that started with C. Just kidding. Very good. Thank you, ladies. You guys can have a seat. Thank you. Okay, so they were really, really proficient in that first activity, weren't they? Really proficient. I mean, they had it down pat. They knew exactly what they were going to say. Once one person stopped, the other person picked it up, and it was great. But what did we do in the second situation? We took away the context. We took away what Victoria had said was what she wanted to say. She knew she had the vocabulary, but we took it away from her. And without that vocabulary, she struggled. That is the context that we're talking about. So just because you have students who seem proficient in their social language, like they're able to tell a story about what they did over the weekend, doesn't necessarily mean that they're ready for cognitively demanding language situations that are context reduced. So photosynthesis is definitely cognitively demanding. It's something that requires a language outside of what we use every day. And as a result, the context is heavily reduced. So when we consider language in the classroom, we have to look at how language looks. And there's typically two types of language that we're looking at. There's the BICS, which is your basic interpersonal communication skills, okay? That's the BICS, the basic interpersonal communication skills. It's basically what you and I use to have a conversation about what we did over the weekend, okay? But then there is also the academic language, which is the cognitive, that's the CALP, the cognitive academic language proficiency. So without CALP, well, because CALP often tends to be more cognitively demanding, and it tends to also be more context reduced. Students are going to have a really, really hard time in the classroom if English is not their first language. Okay? So without the academic language, the context, the girls had a really hard time to explain photosynthesis because they didn't have that context available to them. And think about your kids. Are they these empty vessels who come into your classrooms with no background knowledge of anything? No. They have a wealth of knowledge. It's our job to figure out what it is and to be able to tap into it and use it in the classroom. And we have to remember that. A lot of the times we think that these ESOL students are just, you know, they don't know anything. But the truth is they do know a lot. So we just have to figure out how to pull that and use that to help them to be more successful in the classroom. Okay, so I wanted to show you guys this chart real quick. Jim Cummins is the guy who created this idea of BICS and CALP, which is very simple, but it's actually a little bit more complex. And so what he did was he kind of evolved it and turned it into this dual continua kind of a thing. So it's now like a matrix. So what we have here, up here, are more cognitively undemanding tasks. Things like copying from the board or following a class schedule. Down here are cognitively demanding tasks. Things like science experiments and listening to a lecture, okay? But at the same time, teachers can make cognitively demanding tasks more context embedded, which means they can make it so that the students can actually understand what they're saying. By doing what? By using visuals and graphics, obviously. Visuals and graphics in a social studies lesson, for example, are really helpful for students to be able to figure out what the teacher is trying to say. And it's not only that, there's a whole bunch of other stuff to consider when we're trying to make our lessons more accessible to our students, okay? So, but just kind of as a guide, BICS typically, Jim Cummins did an experiment on like students in Toronto, these French-speaking students, and he figured out that it takes students anywhere from 2 to 7 years to develop just basic interpersonal communication skills. It takes between 5 and 7 years for them to develop their cognitive academic language. So you want to think about how amazing your ESOL kids are when they come into the classroom as teenagers and they have 4 years, if even, to finish high school. And it takes them at least 5 to 7 years to be able to master the cognitive academic language. So think about that. Any questions so far about BICS and CALP? So, what can we do to help with this academic language? Because here's the thing, you can't separate it. You can't say, okay, we're gonna just put them in an ESOL class and teach them the academic, just teach them their basic language for 4 years, and then once they master it, we'll move them into a science class. We can't do that. They have to learn everything simultaneously. So as teachers in the classroom, what can we do to help with our instruction so that these students can grasp the content? Visuals, lots and lots of visuals. How many of you guys are aware of cognates? Cognates. Anyone? What are cognates?
Cognates are like words that aren't exactly the same, but just like the structure of the words is similar to a word that you know in your own language.
Right. Right. If you have a lot of Spanish speakers, cognates are going to be wonderful for them because a lot of the academic language of English is actually Latin-based. And so since Spanish is a Latin-based language, if your kids come to your classroom with a lot of like just academic language in Spanish, cognates are going to be really helpful for them, okay? Word walls, and not just like, I'm just going to throw a bunch of words up there, but make it interactive. Make it so that your kids are doing something with the word walls. Make it bilingual, even if you wanted to, okay? Chem charts, I'm going to show you guys, you have an activity that you're going to be doing with chem charts. It's a way for them to develop language or the academic vocabulary by taking a word and looking for information related to it and then processing it by coming up with a memory cue, okay? Frayer model, some of you guys have seen this in your guys' experiences, great. Change it up for your EL students, okay? Ask them to add maybe a translation in their own language, okay? Ask them to include a picture of some sort, a nonverbal representation, okay? And foldables. Foldables are really cool. We do this when this activity with our teachers in our GECAT program, which is an endorsement program. And basically you take like 3 pieces of paper and you fold it in half and you layer them and it becomes like a flip chart. And then basically you can use that for them to add information. And not just verbal information, but also non-linguistic representations as well, like pictures, okay? Okay, so here's what I want to do with your 3-minute pause. Take the BICS and the CALP. Write down information under the information box. And then in the M box, which is the memory cue, I want you to either write down a word or draw a picture or something to help you remember what BICS and CALP are, okay? So again, it doesn't have to necessarily be something that's a language related. It can be a picture. But if it's a word, if it's gonna help you better as a word, then definitely use that as well, okay? That's your memory cue. So take about 3 minutes to do that. Share with your guys' buddies at your tables and then we'll move on. A pen, a big pen. Proficiency.
Open a phone and send a text message. There it is now.
Okay, about 1 minute left, so finish up. All right, before we move on, do we have any questions so far? Burning questions? We're good? Okay, you got 10 seconds. So finish up your pictures. Color them in with all of your pretty colored pens and pencils and markers. All right. Okay, so number two is comprehensible input. So like I was telling you guys before, a lot of times we get asked if we speak Spanish in order to teach our students, but the reality is you don't have to. You just need comprehensible input. This is really at the crux of what we do as ESL teachers and what you can do as a classroom teacher. You just need to make the message comprehensible to your students. You need to find ways to do that with your students. I was watching this episode of Criminal Minds. Anybody watch that? Okay, so there was this previous episode about this guy who was doing like lobotomies on people, right? Anybody see that one? And how like, and basically this evil guy, he's like from Germany. He's trying to get back at his sister. He's got this like sibling rivalry, whatever. So he's doing lobotomies. Like he first tries it on her boyfriend, his sister's boyfriend, and then on her. And so the thing is though, is that he can understand everything, but he can't speak. So Morgan is having to resort to non-linguistic representations to basically get this guy to be able to communicate with him. So he's using pictures, he's using like a word board or whatnot, just to be able to help this guy to communicate. So what we do is we're just trying to make this message comprehensible. But one of the things to consider though, and this is what Stephen Krashen has picked, this is his brainchild essentially, came up with five hypotheses for second language acquisition. He's saying that we don't just want them to understand what we're saying. We also want to push them. And the reason why we need to push them is because they have to learn the academic content. And so we have to just go beyond what they can do right at that level and push them just a little bit in order for them to be able to gain cognitively as well. Okay? So here are some strategies for comprehensible input. Here are some things that you can do as teachers to help your kids to understand the message you're trying to convey. Gestures, okay? Use gestures if you have to. Something's high or something's low, you know, those kinds of things. Use gestures. Use pictures. Use lots and lots of pictures. I know one of the things that my coworkers and I always did when we were teaching social studies is we would do vocabulary and we would always include pictures. We'd either ask our kids to draw pictures like you guys were doing with your Kim words, or what we would do is we would have pictures and then a word bank and have them use the context clues of those images for them to be able to understand the vocabulary. So pictures. Objects, using realia, bringing stuff into the classroom and letting them manipulate it. So that's another one, manipulatives, just all the way down here. Role playing, letting them have a chance at practicing what it is you're doing. Showing video clips, everyone loves videos. Modeling things, using demonstrations and outlines, especially if you guys are using, if you're teaching like a book or something, right? Which is what you often do, you have your kids read a book. Having an outline of like the major things that are going on in the book often helps your kids to get the major idea of what the book is trying to communicate. One of the things you can do as a teacher is to modify your speech. This is going to be really important. You want to guard your vocabulary. And this is one of those things I had to develop early on. If I started using a word that I realized my kids didn't understand, I would ask them, do you know what that means? And they'll be honest with you. They'll say, no. And then that gives you an opportunity to teach them at the very moment what that word means, or even to use cognates or whatever resources you have, okay? So guard your vocabulary. Also think about the idiomatic expressions that are used all the time, either in your language or in the languages of your students, okay? So reduce that, or be very intentional in teaching them and stopping your instruction and teaching them what that idiomatic expression means, okay? Slow your rate of speech. this is important for your kids, don't have to raise your voice, just slow your rate of speech, okay? Enunciate your words very clearly. That's going to help them as well. Repeat your key ideas. Repeating usually gives students an idea that, hey, maybe that's important because the teacher keeps talking about it. Pause frequently. Pause frequently, let them have a chance to just kind of like digest the information and ask questions if they need to. And when you are asking questions, wait a little bit longer than you typically would. That wait time is really important for your ELs. They're processing this information in their first language, and then they're having to give you output in the second language. That takes a lot of work internally, so think about that, okay? Graphic organizers are great when it comes to working with English learners, but not all graphic organizers are self-explanatory, and I definitely had this experience working with my ELs. Don't just give them a graphic organizer and expect that they know how to use it. You definitely want to make sure that you scaffold the graphic organizer and give yourself an opportunity to teach them how to use it as a class, essentially, before you send them off to doing it by themselves. And this is why I say consider using it as a joint product. So instead of giving them a Venn diagram, do it together as a class. Do it together as a class so that way you give your kids a chance to see how it's done, so that the next time you can give them a chance to practice it on their own. Okay? So, one couple more things. When it comes to written text, what are some things you can do to make the text more accessible for your students? Supplement them and modify them. Develop study guides, okay? So figure out what it is that you're going to be studying in this unit and create a study guide for them. Outlines, graphic organizers, visuals, timelines, anything that you can get their hands on to help them to figure out what to expect. Include focus questions, key vocabulary and definitions, an outline of major concepts, and even consider adapting the text or rewriting the text yourself. I've had to do this multiple times and have also had to look outside for resources that basically reduced the amount of verbiage that was in my world history textbook so that my kids could actually understand it, okay? We're pretty lucky we had our publisher create what was called a reading study guide, which was like a condensed version of the reading, but it gave the key ideas and helped us to just get them to where we needed them to be. So look for those resources or do it yourself if you're brave enough to, okay? Reserve textbooks and add notes to margins so that way the kids have an extra resource to look for when they're trying to figure out what these things are saying, okay? And then highlight the text to signal central concepts and key vocabulary. Any questions so far? I'm giving you guys a lot, okay? It's a lot, so just if you have any questions, let me know. Here's one of the coolest things that I recently ran into, or I recently discovered, jumpstart files. What do we typically do when we jumpstart something? Anybody? Jump-starting a car. Yes. You're quickly starting, you're getting it going, right? So one of the things that you can do with your kids to get them going, to quickly start the lesson, is to either give them a file, or if you have a co-teacher who's going to be with you in the classroom, letting the co-teacher do a jump-start lesson with your kids, okay? So giving them a chance to preview the information so that way they know what to expect as they're getting into it. This teacher that did it, I found this information from Judith Ransbroni. She actually did such a neat thing. She put her kids into like these little classroom communities, small groups of like three students. And she started out by giving them the Jumpstart files, essentially. And then she placed the responsibility on the group members to create Jumpstart files for each other. And then at the end of the year, she placed the responsibility on the ESOL student to create a Jumpstart file for the rest of the kids. So they give a lot, she gives a lot of resources, a lot of practice for the kids, and then turns the tables on them and asks them to do this for them. So you're basically just building them up to that cognitively demanding task. So kind of a cool thing to do. Include study guides, graphic organizers, visuals, and adapted text just to give them a preview of what to expect. And of course, give clear and explicit instructions. I just once had this kid who, I may talk about this later, who I had an assignment for them and they respond, the assignment was to, one of the questions was to draw a conclusion. And he came up to me and he literally drew a conclusion. It's a picture. So definitely be clear and explicit about your instructions when you're asking them to do these kinds of things. Write it down, say it out loud, and repeat it, okay? Because they definitely do appreciate that. And of course, as you would with any good teaching, frequently check for understanding. Stop your instruction, ask questions, use thumbs up, thumbs downs, or whatever it is. Make them ask you a question so that you're constantly assessing if they're getting the content, okay? Okay, now, input is great, but it's only made better if there are opportunities for output. You can't allow your ELLs to be indefinitely silent. So, you know, in the when you study, if you ever get into trying to get your endorsement, one of the things that you'll learn about is like stages of language acquisition. And basically, there is a point when the kids are very silent. And a lot of the times, teachers are like, oh, he's still in the silent stage. So I'm just going to let him be in the silent stage. But if you're doing that forever, you're basically building a crutch for them. So definitely try to build their confidence as much as you can by telling them ahead of time, hey, I want you to like answer number 5 today or something like that. Okay, build their confidence. Allow them to work collaboratively all the time with their peers so that they build that trust with their peers so that eventually they'll become comfortable enough to be able to produce information. Okay, so here's what I want you guys to do now. I'm going to do a 3-2-1 exercise with you. And this 3-2-1 exercise, did I skip something? Oh, yes, I did. Sorry. I do this all the time because I think I may have forgotten somewhere to put it in my presentation. Nope, it's not there. Okay, so before we get to this 3-2-1 activity, I want you to just take a couple of minutes and just think about some things that you currently can do to change your practice to make it more comprehensible for your guys' students. So think about everything that I just gave you, because it's a lot of information, okay? And just come up with three things, three goals maybe, just what you can do the next time you're in the classroom to make your content more comprehensible for your students. And then we'll do the 3-2-1 activity. All right, guys, I'm going to go ahead and get us going for the sake of time, because we've still got a couple of things to cover. Here's what I'm going to do. You guys are already talking about great storm of a bunch of ideas that you're going to start changing in your guys' lessons, which is great. So what we're going to do is go ahead and move on to social interaction, and here is what I want you to do with social interaction. The first thing I want you to do is to work independently, okay? I want you to think about three reasons why collaborative learning should be used in the classroom, okay? And then I want you to write two struggles that you've encountered, that you heard about when it comes to using collaborative grouping in a classroom. And then the last thing I want you to do is to write one question in regards to collaborative learning, okay? So take just a few minutes, write those things down. Three reasons why it should be used, two struggles with it, and then one question. When you have your 3-2-1, I want you to buddy up with an elbow partner and share your responses. And this is when we rein back in. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and have you guys regroup, come back. Okay, now because we have like 15 minutes left, typically what I would do is I would then go ahead and ask you guys to your buddies to get together as a group, which you were already doing anyway. You were extending your conversations beyond just the two of you into like your groups because, you're sitting with like 3 or 4 or 5 other people. So that's kind of a natural development, natural pattern in like human nature. So you are going to go ahead and start discussing with the rest of your groupmates. You're going to start overhearing conversations and whatnot. What I would have loved to do is have you guys just summarize your findings and then just report out. Because what I'm trying to model with you guys and then do a whole class discussion is what we call tipsy. Okay, tipsy is a strategy, and I'll go, I know, it's tough. Maybe this was not an appropriate acronym for this age group, I don't know. But tipsy is an acronym that we use to try to basically help teachers to remember groupings in the classroom. Now, this is one of those things where you use it to help scaffold participation. Your English learners are going to be a little bit reticent because they don't have the language, obviously. So they don't feel like they're ready to take risks and to go ahead and just jump in and talk and whatnot. And a lot of the times in secondary schools, teachers tend to just stand up here at the front and say, okay, all right, who knows the answer to number 5, you know? Or, okay, John, can you tell me what photosynthesis is? So what this does is instead of putting your ELLs in that kind of a high-risk situation, it basically gives them an opportunity to work independently so that they have time to think about their responses, and then to work with a buddy so that they can kind of like just negotiate meaning with each other, and then to work in a smaller group setting where they might be a little bit more comfortable to start participating, and then eventually, hopefully, at some point, to take part in whole group discussions, okay? And so this doesn't necessarily have to be one of those things where you have to be so intentional in like, you know, the way that you're organizing, it can happen in a heartbeat. Yes.
So it goes backwards.
So this is just kind of to help you remember the acronym. TIPSY is to help you remember the acronym. But it can be used in whatever arrangement that you want, as long as you're really thinking about how you're scaffolding participation from your ELs, okay? Now, why is this important? I'm gonna go backwards now. Social interaction is going to be the way that your students are gonna learn English, okay? If they're going to learn English, they need to interact with this language. They need that interaction, okay? And that's why collaborative work is so important in the classroom, because it gives them that opportunity to really start negotiate meaning with their classmates, to really start trying to figure out how language works, okay? So that's why it's so important. And you wanna also think about this. Vygotsky talks about the zone of proximal development, right? About how you want your students to just to have someone that's gonna be able to push them along, like a mentor. Your peer, native speaking peers in the classroom can serve as those kinds of mentors. If you are really intentional in grouping your students, just look at the behavior patterns. Look at who talks to who and try to pair them up with each other. That mentor student, that native speaking student, is going to be so incredible as an aid to help pull along your English learner, okay? So think about that when you guys are pairing up your students. Random is great from time to time, but intentional is always best. So thinking about who works best in your classroom as a group, and then thinking about who can really be the person to help your English learners to push them along, okay? So that's TIPSY. Now, some other things you can do, some other ideas for just having them work together in small groups, of course, carousel activities. Carousel activities, you know, are those activities where you may have like posters or whatnot, and then they kind of like circle from station to station, and they work together in small groups. And then jigsaw activities, which is when you're dividing up a task and having them work together with that. Now, obviously, here's the kicker. You never want to give your kids something like that's very meaningless, and that's something that doesn't allow for accountability. So always make sure that you guys are giving them roles and that there's always going to be a completed product involved. And one thing that I'm just thinking about right now as I'm remembering this, team accountability. Allowing the other members of the group to be able to like rate the team members and their contributions to whatever it is that they're doing, okay? So these are some things to consider as well when it comes to social interaction. Okay, any questions about social interaction? All right, am I missing anything in social interaction? Are you supposed to do like something else? Okay, good. All right, just wanted to make sure. Okay, I heard some talk about this earlier. I think, what was your name, young man?
Zach.
So this is Zach, who actually put his name on his question.
That's right.
Okay, so he was talking about this earlier, and I kind of overheard this conversation. He was talking about how like we use our native language when we're trying to learn a foreign language, right? So you're like sitting in Spanish or French or German class, and you are using English all the time to try to figure out how to learn German or French or Spanish or whatever language you're learning. So why is it not, and he posed this question, why is it not appropriate for our students, our English learners, to use their language to learn what we're trying to teach them? And it's a valid point. And I want to back it up with Virginia Collier and Wayne Thomas's 15-year study on English learner programming here in the United States. So from 1982 to like 1996, I think those are the dates. Don't write that down. They did this study on all these programs in the United States. Dual immersion programs, which are like programs where you teach them both their first language and a second language together. And then they also did studies on like the shelter programs, and then studies of schools who did pull out and push in. Push in is where your English co-teacher, your ESL teacher goes in. Pull out is when they go out and work with the teacher. They did studies on all of those. And you know what they found? They found this. This is where your average native speakers are performing, at the 50th percentile of this normative curve, whatever it is. Now, when you start teaching kids in both their first and their second language, eventually, from first grade, kindergarten, all the way to 11th grade, they surpass their native speaking peers. What does that tell you about their native language? It's powerful. It is a vehicle for them to be able to learn and to be able to get that academic content. Now, granted, we're in Georgia. It's a pretty conservative state, and legislation here is really not in favor of doing something like a dual immersion school, and any people who have tried it here in Georgia have gotten a lot of flack for it. Ask Del Perry if you ever get a chance to take a class with her, or Del Giles now. She opened the first charter public dual immersion school down in Clayton County. Lots and lots and lots of flack for it because of the idea of teaching kids their native language. People are just like, what? They're supposed to be learning English. But the problem is when we take away their native language and force them to learn the English language without any support of the native language, they falter, they struggle, Yes.
But how do we do that if we ourselves do not speak the language?
Exactly.
Multiple languages.
Right. Right. Definitely. How do we do that? We have to go back to what she was saying earlier, where we have to just consider our students and where they are. And one of the things I'm going to suggest for you when it comes to looking at your native language and the next thing, which is the affective filter, is getting to know who your students are and finding out about their background and how much academic language they have in their first language. Because like I was saying before, and I had this encounter too, I had kids who were in the ninth grade, who were 15 years old, who had been in ESOL since first grade. They had never left the program. Never left the program. And you know what? They could talk up a storm about what they did over the weekend and about, you know, what movie they saw or whatever. But when it came time to talk about world history, they couldn't tell me anything. They couldn't tell me much of anything because they didn't have the academic language. And you know, I think a lot about how we educated them, how we took away their first language and said, you have to learn English, you have to learn English, you have to learn English. And we never taught them in their first language. Could that be a contributor to why they're still in ESOL as a 15-year-old? Definitely. And this is what Thomas and Collier are telling us. So what do we do then if we don't have that resource? You just have to encourage them to use it in the classroom. Encourage them to use it when they can use it, to look up words to help them to figure out meaning, to talk to a peer who speaks the same language about the content, buddy them up with someone who speaks the same language to help them to be able to understand what it is that the task is being asked of them. Okay, those are the kinds of things that you can do as a teacher, just trying to figure out where they are literacy-wise and academic-wise in their native language, and then encouraging them to use it if that is definitely something that's going to help them. Now, obviously, if you have a kid who is probably not, is what I call a balanced bilingual, who's like equally fluent in both languages, it's going to be a lot harder. There are going to have to be a lot of external interventions to come in to help them to be able to read and write and those kinds of things. But if you do have a student who definitely has a lot of native language literacy, use it to your advantage, okay? Use it to help them. So utilize your bilingual students and make sure you guide them. Help them to say, okay, this is what I want you to do today to help this student. Because you don't want that bilingual peer, the one who can speak both languages, to become a crutch for your native, for your English learner. You don't want them to always rely on the student. So give them an opportunity to figure out what they should be doing and what they shouldn't be doing to help your ELLs, okay? Allow them to write in their native language, and then maybe help them to work on expressing it in English, okay? And there are lots of resources nowadays online for students to be able to like read stuff in their native language, to be able to translate it back into English or whatnot. So use what you can to help them, especially since these are secondary learners, to get them to where they need to be, okay? If that native language is gonna work, then use it because it's going to help them. It's gonna serve as that scaffold to bridge them to where they need to be academically, okay? So, and then provide materials in other languages to supplement your course materials. So if there are other materials, you know, get your hands on dictionaries. Get your hands on, you know, books in other languages or whatnot that are going to be able to help your students in the classroom. Okay? Any other questions about the first language? Because I have 5 minutes now. Okay, cognates. Earlier we were talking about cognates, and here's one of my favorite sites, Colorin, Colorado, which actually should be Colorin, Colorado. It's for Spanish speakers. Cognates for Spanish speakers and any other students who may speak a Latin language is really going to be able to use this. But it's got a lot of cognates. And then one of the resources that I gave you guys, that Megan said to all of you guys, also has a list of cognates as well. Okay? Okay. Now this is where we would pause and you would do a cute little vanity plate and whatnot. Okay, but we're going to move on. Because we're running out of time. Okay, so here's another big thing to keep in mind. The affective filter. So what does this picture tell you already?
Nervous.
Yeah, they're nervous. Okay, because that's how your ELLs feel when they come into the classroom. And you know what? All of my ELLs that I've taught in my shelter class, they're like, Miss, I don't want to go to the mainstream class. I don't want to. And because they're nervous. They don't feel comfortable. They're like, oh, they make fun of you. And you know, all those kinds of things. Because, and it's true, they get this kind of feeling, these feelings of stigmatism and anxiety, being unwelcomed and ignored in the classroom. So they already come into the classroom feeling this way. So what we need to do as teachers is we've got to figure out a way to lower what Krashen calls the affective filter. This affective filter is like a wall. And if your kids come in and that wall goes up and it just stays there, they are never going to learn anything, even if you've made everything in your power comprehensible, okay? Because that wall, that anxiety, I mean, think about it. It's the same thing for you if you were to learn a second language and you were feeling that anxious in the classroom. You wouldn't learn anything, okay? So bear that in mind. It can lead to withdrawal from social interaction, and without that social interaction, they're not going to be able to learn English, okay? So be vigilant about creating this kind of an environment. Now, what can you do? Get to know your English learners, okay? meet them at the beginning of the school year, make a biography card on them. This is one of the coolest things that I've gotten out of this program that I'm working with, biography cards, okay? Make a card of your students, have their picture on it, find out what language they speak, what country they're from, how long have they been in the United States? What do they like to do? What kind of schooling do they have in their first, you know, where it was they came from, okay? And then make a folder on them and add to it as you observe new things about them so that you're always keeping in mind where your student is at so you know how to help them in the classroom, okay? So that is going to help you to be able to get to know them. And then give yourself an opportunity for them to get to know you as well, because you want them to see you as not just la maestra or la maestro, you know, the teacher who is like distant and far away. Give them a chance to get to know you as well, okay? Create a classroom community. So this lady earlier, I kind of told you a little bit about her, how she created these Jumpstart files. She also did this really cool thing where she started putting her kids into groups based on who they were interacting with, her ELLs, and then she used these groups basically as a way to create a classroom community that invited everybody to be able to contribute, including her English learners. So it's kind of a really cool thing. I'll post the article. I'll send it to Megan so you guys can see it as well. Okay, and one of the other things that she did was a getting to know you assignment at the beginning of the year. These are always kind of, the beginning of the year is always kind of that time where there's a lot of low kind of like key activities going on because there's not a lot of expectations just yet, unless you're like my principal and you're like, oh, teach you on the first day. But if you do kind of have this low key experience on the first couple of days of school, use that as an opportunity for your kids, not just for you to get to know your kids, but for your kids to get to know each other as well. So assign some sort of an activity where they get to know each other at the beginning of the year, okay? Seek out opportunities to allow them to contribute. Okay, Louise Moll and a bunch of other researchers found out that, you know what? The Hispanic community, because this is where they were working, they have like all of these resources that we can bring into the classroom and make it really valid and applicable for learning. So look at what your kids and their background know, like what their families know how to do, and see if there are ways that you can incorporate that. One of the teachers that I'm working with in Habersham Central, one of the things that she's going to start doing more of this year, since there is, I think, more flexibility with Common Core to choose your reading, right? To choose what you're reading. She's going to be a lot more intentional in choosing literature that represents the cultures of her students. So think about those kinds of things so that you can validate their cultures in the classroom. That's going to help to lower that affective filter, okay? Your classroom itself. Make a concerted effort to make the environmental print more reflective of who the students are in your classroom. That's going to really make them feel welcome. Imagine that kid walking in your classroom and you're like, you already have a clock up there that shows the time zone from wherever he's from. That's kind of cool. Makes them really feel welcome in the classroom, you know? Classroom routines are going to be great because it's going to help them to realize that, hey, I know what to expect. At the beginning of class, we've got some sort of bell work, and then I've got to turn in my homework assignment. This is going to help those ELLs who are like brand new to the country and just need a routine so that they can start getting comfortable in the school environment, okay? All right, and then I was going to have you do this biography card thing, but we're going to move on. Let me just finish up with linguistic form and function real quick, because this one is going to be easier for you guys since you teach language arts, okay? So a lot of what you guys do already is requiring you to look at the language of all of the disciplines. And you're having to break that down in the classroom and teach your kids how to write like persuasively and like informational and expository and, you know, narratively. So think about what language is needed in your classroom so that you know how to instruct your students to get to that language so that they can understand what they need to do, okay? So let's just skip through this. You guys can read the rest of this. And I'm going to skip this as well. And then what I was going to have you do was summarize with your guys' big sticky note chart. Woohoo! Okay, what words stand out to you?
Explain.
So what one concept is that coming out of? Out of the six that we looked at? Explain. Comprehensible input. This is actually a survey that I took of some ESOL students from Norcross. And this was the number one thing that they loved about the ESOL teacher, that they explain. So take time to explain things and make your content comprehensible. Now, what else stands out to you? Help and understand. Yes, understand and explain. Help and funny. Because you know what? At the end of the day, if they hate your content area, at least they love you, right? Okay, that's my mantra, okay? Attitude is everything, guys. You really want to start shifting the way you think about your ESOL students and start being that wildfire that spreads to everybody else in your school environment, because your kids are assets. They're not liabilities, okay? So change from the heart And all of these instructional tools that you have on your belt are going to make that much more of an impact in your classroom. Okay? So go and change the world.